really two parts. The first is about what we do as consultants and things you can do, what sort of help is available, what sort of questions you can ask us, and what sort of questions we will ask you. Sort of get you started on what you need to do to prepare for research, and hopefully to get you started on the right track towards good research. The second part of this is a little more mechanical, talking about how you organize data and actually get it in a simple database and get it ready for research and ready for analysis. So this is the CME boilerplate. This is a one credit class. I think if you haven't signed up already, the sign-up forms are in the back. Haley can help you out with that if you have any questions. I have no financial interest in this other than I work here. And there's also an evaluation form, which if you don't have one already, they're available in back. I'd like to have you fill one out before you go. So the goals of this are to let you know what's available, give you an idea of what it takes to translate a research idea into a hypothesis, organize the data, and some things not to do. So one of the, I think the biggest thing we have to offer is between all of our faculty and staff is we have a lot of experience in actually doing statistical analysis. We've done many hundreds of these analyses over the years. And we've seen some very similar questions before. And that can be really helpful when you're coming in trying to answer a research question. You may have completely new data, but a lot of times the questions are very similar to what's come before. It's one of my favorite XKCD comics. Sort of making fun of statistics. So a lot of times, some of the most productive meetings are just talking about the research question. Sometimes, especially if you're just getting started, you just need to define what that question is and how it can be answered. Sometimes there are alternate views or alternate ways to look at it. If you've had basic statistics, you know the simple methods, but there are more advanced methods for doing comparisons, and also some methods of doing different hypotheses that you wouldn't have covered in an introductory course. And ultimately, we like to take those ideas and formulate them into a testable hypothesis. So people come to us really at various stages. It could be right at the beginning, it could be right at the end. So I set this up. Working towards from both ends towards the middle. Sometimes it starts with that really inception of the idea. I've got this idea, what do I do with it? And on the other end, you might have been through all the research, submitted the manuscript, and the reviewers come back with comments saying, well, you need some help with the statistics. So we get both of those, and everything in the middle. So there's some additional questions about how large is my sample? How much do I need to answer the question? Or maybe you've done the result, done your own analysis, you have a result, but you don't understand fully what it means. So the interpretation of certain statistical methods is not always immediate, especially if you don't have a lot of experience. The availability of statistical software is slightly easier to come by now, but the college now has SPSS licenses. Not a lot of people have them yet. But you can do some of this analysis on your own. Won't necessarily tell you what it means or whether you're doing the correct analysis. And then there's some practical questions. How do you organize the data? If you have a complex study, there's a lot that needs to go into that and some basic rules you need to follow. I'll be talking a little bit more about that later. Or it could just be how do you do this test? You know exactly what you need, but you need a little help, advice, giving the right direction on how to use the method. So we have really all range of people, people who have the question and need help with everything in the middle, or have their own data, have their own analysis done, but have some questions on interpretation, and they don't need our help doing the actual analysis. All manner of questions in there that we can help with. So probably the go back to this for a second. The question I don't like to hear, and I don't hear it too much anymore, so we're doing something right. The question I don't like to hear is, I've got my data, what do I do now? So if you've gone through the point of gathering data without the idea, without a plan for doing the analysis, that's often an indicator of trouble. Because if you haven't planned ahead, you might not have what you need. And fortunately, we have let people know we're available. Most people are coming to us very early now. And it's usually a couple of years, actually, between that initial idea and then the final publication. But it's always good to hear from people up front and get them started off on the right path for how to do that. So some basic questions that we want to know is, what is your hypothesis? What is the design of the study or the experiment, specifically the statistical design? So we see a lot of people with laboratory data, and they, when describing their design, they describe all the laboratory details, but not the design of what the statistical comparison is. So usually it's something very simple, maybe a two-group study, but the designs can be much more complex. There could be stratification in your data, there could be clustering, and applying the right method is important. Sometimes the question is limited by the data you have. And so knowing what data you have or what data you need to go collect is really important to set up the right analysis. So I like to tell people that a good hypothesis should be a simple statement, a sentence. You don't have to specifically say that the null hypothesis is X, but if you say this sentence to someone, they should be able to figure it out. There should be terms in there that are well defined. So you don't have to define them all in one sentence, but sometimes you get a hypothesis that treatment A will be better than treatment B. Better is not a well-defined word. You have to define how is it better. And that can be quite tricky sometimes. We help plan a study looking at maintaining high blood pressure following a stroke to try to keep problems from developing. And the better was of maintaining the blood pressure in a specific range, specific rather narrow range, and being able to achieve that and measure when it was achieved was actually quite difficult. And then explaining what that meant was also difficult. And those are the sort of questions you have to think about. If we hadn't thought about that one ahead of time, it would have been probably impossible to do the study at all. Typically, a hypothesis test is looking for a difference between groups, but there are other hypotheses. One is equivalence, so showing that within some tolerance, two treatments are the same or two methods are the same. There's also agreement or reliability. We see a fair number of studies that they just want to know how accurately they can measure something, or between two different people looking at the same thing, how much agreement is there between them, or do they disagree? And sometimes you don't have a hypothesis. If you're just doing a descriptive study, you shouldn't force a hypothesis. I know a lot of times people like to have one so they can have a p-value and report something, but if it's just descriptive, the hypothesis and the p-value is at the primary interest. You want some good estimates of your data from your data and some confidence intervals for describe how accurately you've measured it. And finally, you want a feasible design. So it's quite possible to have an idea and plan something out for which we don't actually have a statistical method to match it. And so sometimes there has to be a little compromise to find a way that we can actually create analysis for you. So obviously you'd like to have some power to detect a difference or show equivalence or whichever your hypothesis is. And you'd like that difference to be clinically meaningful. So it happens occasionally that you have a very large sample size. It's easy to show a difference, but that difference is so small that nobody cares. So a small p-value doesn't always mean anything useful. It's good to control for other factors. So if you know typically age and sex are something to control for in most analyses, you want to control for these factors where you know there's something related, and we can, through analysis, control for other sources of variability and give you a better estimate and more accurate p-values for the primary hypothesis. Preliminary data is often useful for estimating that. Or even just looking at it to sort of put the right ideas in the head of what the questions are. So here's an example I actually put together from a couple of different events. I sometimes get people calling me up for a chi-square test. They have a couple of numbers, they just want me to do a chi-square test for them. And this was one of those cases. I've had this one happen a couple times actually. So they called me up. I said, sure, I can do that. They read me off these four numbers I haven't read. And I calculated the percentages. I filled in the rest of the table. And I did the chi-square test. Small p-value, it's significant. But then I had to ask them, well, you know, if you're just collecting surveys, these were surveys, it's sort of unusual that you would happen to get equal numbers in these two groups. So either they did that intentionally, or I asked them, is this really two groups of 184 people each, and you asked them each this question, or is it one group of 184, and you asked two questions? That was the problem here. In one group, they don't really have 368 people, so this is the wrong approach to this question. The right one is McNamara's test. Different arrangement of the table, so there's the numbers of 184. So we have the right total sample size here. The p-value is still significant, it's even a little smaller, I don't think that matters much. And we have a pair data odds ratio, so the ratio of these two numbers. So we have the same answer, and we weren't getting the wrong answer in this case, but we have the right methods, which is what we want. It can make a difference to apply the right methods. So some things we can help you with are understanding the data you have. There's a lot of people using some of these publicly available databases now, the NIS, recently the National Cancer Database, people are doing a lot of research with that. So there's a lot of data available, but managing these big databases can be a lot of work, and you may not have the resources to do that. We have SAS, which is a big database program, we can help you with those questions. Occasionally, people have, they can do their own analysis, they just need a little help with that data management. We can help with that too. So getting your data set up right takes along the path of doing good research. So what we would like to be able to give you and set you up with is the best methods for the data you have. Alternately, if the methods don't quite match what you need, get the data you need for what can be done. And sometimes the data will suggest additional analyses that hadn't been part of the original plan, but occasionally lead to some interesting results. So here's our current faculty and staff. Kosh Law is our new acting director, who just lost Dr. Fine a few months ago, unfortunately. We have drop-in sessions where you can just, if someone's on call, you can stop by and ask us questions. We have that every day of the week, usually 1 to 3 in the afternoon, although Wednesday morning tend to be over just upstairs here in a bit. And there's a session this afternoon, actually, just upstairs. The other sessions are either in our offices or over in the pavilion building. And I don't think there's anyone from Marquette here today, but we have faculties over at Marquette 2 days a week, Jessica Brzezinski. So she is available for people at Marquette to drop in over there. These are our regular full-time personnel, full-time faculty, that is. And our staff, statisticians, and Kaylee's, our administrator, keeps things running very, very efficiently for us. I've been doing this for 15 years now. I've done a little bit of everything, pretty much. We have some very experienced other statisticians who are available to help you out. So, briefly, when you come to a meeting, bring your ideas, your protocol, if you have it. We always like to read ahead and try to be prepared if you have a written protocol. Sometimes it's establishing that protocol is why people come to see us, so that's okay if you don't have it. An example of the data, what does it actually look like if we have some data? It doesn't have to be a huge amount, but just having something to point at and look at, see what the potential range the data is, what we might expect from it, that's useful. That could be an electronic copy. And it helps to bring the person who's actually in charge of doing the research. We talk to a lot of students, and sometimes the students have a little bit different idea of what the research is than the primary investigator behind it. So we'd like to get established what's the right analysis to do right up front. Saves a little bit of trouble. We do have data entry service available, that is for a fee. We have Linda Quint, who's been doing that for a very long time. She's pretty fast. If you have a modest amount of, even a fairly large amount of data, she can get it done for you pretty quickly. And then just in general, we help with all manner of things. I occasionally even get called in to help someone who's reviewing a paper for someone else, and they don't understand the statistics. That's why they actually help people understand the statistics on papers they're reviewing. We're supported by the CTSI grant, which funds most of our activities. Obviously, we try to steer things to where there's some grant funding behind that, but our FERT services are free for translational research and cancer-related research. We have a monthly lecture series, which is just getting going again.
Today's the first day?
Okay. But there'll be some other speakers coming up in the series, and I think Kaylee probably has that scheduled back there.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a newsletter, which you can sign up for to receive electronically. Kaylee probably has a couple of copies of that back too.
No, I do not, but they're listed on our website, okay. PDF files.
We try to write quarterly, we try to write a couple of articles about statistics or a particular analysis. Mostly it's a way to give people an idea if they want to know, well, what is logistic regression? We have an article that talks about logistic regression in simple terms that you can look up and read for yourself. There's our list of institutions right now. I didn't specifically put the Cancer Center on here, but that's part of MCW. And those were our drop-in sessions. The VA room may move in the future,
but for now, that's set in that location. And then Cancer Center, we're upstairs in the clinical trial support room Wednesday morning, Friday afternoon. This is the tricky one. Frederick Pavilion. We've been doing those drop-in sessions for a time, but we sort of alternate between their computer lab and their conference room, depending on what's available. So if you stop in there, and you don't see us, go talk to April, and she'll send you to the other room where we're at. Usually we have a sign-up, so that shouldn't be a problem. And we have our brochures. I have some cards in the back if you need to contact us. Okay, so that was the first part. Are there questions about specifically about our consulting services at this point? Well, good. I must pay the other one. Okay. So, a big part of what we do for analysis is actually database management. Taking the data that's given to us and kicking it around, rearranging it, editing it a little bit to where we can actually use it for analysis. Usually this is something fairly simple, but sometimes we have to communicate fairly extensively and explain what we need, because if there's some heavy changes needed, that's really hard for me to do and know that I've done correctly, because I don't have access to the original data. Also, if I screw it up, I don't have access to the data to fix it. So when I can communicate with people, tell them what's necessary in the data and to get them on the right track. It also makes the research more efficient. So the idea is pretty simple. It's an organized collection of data. Obviously, you want it available on the computer. You'd like to be sortable. So you'd like to be able to, for each different variables that you set up, you'd like to maybe put in name order or date order or maybe by treatment groups. And that's useful because it helps you scan through your data and find problems. Obviously, you'd like to be searchable. So you want, if there's something that you'd like to search and find a particular value. And for more complicated data, you want it to be indexed. So I'll come back to that in a little bit more detail. Good data enables good research. If the data has a lot of problems, it's hard to even do analysis on it. And sometimes, obviously, it can lead to the wrong answers because there's problems with the data. We work on some really rather intricate studies involving multiple longitudinal follow-ups, surveys, and clinical visits over time. And it takes careful organization to track that kind of data in a usable way. Unfortunately, some people, when they start creating their databases, they'll start recording everything without a particular plan for how it's going to be used. And that can be very difficult to take that sort of database and then turn it into an analysis database. So here's an example. It's a spreadsheet. A spreadsheet is a database. It's a simple one. So we have, in this case, an identifying number. I've forgotten what study this is. So this is actually from the NASH case control study. These are the controls. So these are IDs of the controls. And we have 2-to-1 matching for most patients. There's two cases for control number 2. So we have an ID there to be able to match those up. So we have a couple of variables. Ethnicity, and here they've actually put the ID codes. They've used the numeric coding for ethnicity But if you actually put it right there in that cell, I'd like to have that split up a little bit, but this is actually pretty clean. I can tell what this is, and it's pretty easy to fix this and it's ready for analysis. So I get asked sometimes whether something should be numerically coded or if it's okay to have text. The important part is it should be consistent. And numerical coding forces you to be consistent. So there's different ways that you can code ethnicity, but if you set up a scheme, numbered scheme, you're sort of forced to follow a particular pattern. And the computer will recognize uppercase and lowercase as different things. I can fix that, but it's an extra step to fix it. So a lot of times there's a lot of communication about, well, how do I fix the data? It's always nice to get it right up front. So spreadsheets will let you do pretty much whatever you want, which is nice, you can do anything you want with them. It's not so good for research because sometimes anything you can do doesn't work, and we have to move that data from a spreadsheet to our database program for analysis. So spreadsheets don't have very many rules, but databases have pretty strict rules. So you might, for instance, require numeric coding for all your variables or specific variables in your database so that they can be clearly defined. If you have basically applied an equivalent rule in your spreadsheet, you're fine. It should be consistent. So the more rules you have for your spreadsheet, the more it is like a real research database. So databases have some additional capacity in addition to spreadsheets. So basically anything you can do to manipulate a spreadsheet, we can write a program to do in a database. The big advantage of that is it's repeatable. So if there's a certain value that needs to be recoded as something else, and later you decide that's wrong, it's very easy to switch that back with the program. Usually we start with the raw data, the program fixes it, when you do analysis, you can go back and change your program, undo that change, and you still have the original data. So in terms of doing repeatable research, that's a pretty important step. It is not uncommon for people to come back to us even a year or two after analysis is complete, and they have maybe a little bit more information or a correction. And so having a program that does those corrections is really essential. Otherwise, you'd be starting over and cleaning up your data. So, a simple database is really just sometimes called a flat file or a table where you have a grid of data. A couple problems that occur in spreadsheets. Copy-paste errors are problematic. They're easy to make, very difficult to detect. There have been a few times where I've caught a copy-paste error because there were two ages were recorded two different ways. They had both age, birth date, and clinic date. So when I calculated the age, I came up with a different number, and there was a block of patients that were wrong. I knew it was a copy-paste error, but you could, unless you actually do the math on that, you couldn't tell just by looking. I would guess that I've seen other people's research data that have had copy-paste errors and they're completely undetectable. And they were a little surprised when the research didn't find anything, but it's an undetectable error. I can't see it. You can't fix it. If you do have to do a lot of work in a spreadsheet, save ongoing copies. So if you make one set of changes, save it under a new name, carry on, save it under a new name. Because if you make a mistake anywhere in that process in the spreadsheet, you probably can't go back unless you have saved copies. So I one time lost 3 days of work, and now I don't do that anymore. I try to take it straight to SAS and make all my corrections there. There are some times, however, where it's actually not feasible when you have to do some things in the spreadsheet. But we try to avoid that. So, it's easy to spot errors in databases. One I was just dealing with earlier this week, they had a bunch of dates. We were looking at time to event for the analysis, doing some survival analysis, and there were some dates that were wrong. Dates will often look perfectly correct in a spreadsheet, but when you try to read them into your computer in a date format, they're not really dates. So sometimes if you type in text that looks like a date in Excel, it's perfectly happy, but it's not really a date. Excel formats that display dates in a certain way, so you type in 1/1/2012, it will display January 1st, 2012. Those are helpful. They help a lot, but they don't solve all the problems. So a couple things to talk about. I'll have my type formatting. So date formatting is one thing you can do in Excel. You can also force character formatting or numeric formatting. There are sometimes when you want numbers to actually be characters, alphanumeric data. The best example of that might be medical record numbers, which sometimes have leading zeros. If you put that into just a regular unformatted spreadsheet cell, leading zeros go away. And that might be okay, but if you have a complex database and you have to do some merging from multiple sources later, we have to then go back and recreate that correct medical record number to be able to merge it. So a couple things I'll talk about here. I think this is the bad list. Sorry, didn't get there quite yet. So, briefly, there's different types of data, ranging from categorical, ordinal, interval, and ratio, with different amounts of statistical information in them. So, that's maybe a little more detail than most people need, but those are the sorts of things we need to know statistically, because there's different statistical methods for each of these that we might use. The other thing that's not listed here is censored information, where you have time to event, but maybe you don't observe the event for every patient. Maybe it's censored. Then just physically, going from Excel to SAS, you might have character data, which is text, numeric data, which is a number that you can actually do math with, dates, which are typically actually numbers with a specific internal format. Dates can cause a lot of trouble sometimes, so we spend a lot of time trying to fix them. And obviously, sometimes data can only be censored but missing. If you're entering data, and you have a partially entered data set, it can be important to actually put in a value for things that you look for, but they're not there, they're missing. Because when you come back to check things or correct things, it's important to know whether you looked for it and it wasn't there, or if you just haven't tried to put it there yet. So sometimes putting in a specific value, maybe if it's age, put in -99, something which wouldn't ever be used for an age, put that in to mark that you looked for the age, but it wasn't there. Age is a bad example, it's usually available, but some lab tests might be missing, the more common one. So this is my list of things that I commonly see in Excel that really aren't too helpful. More than one value in a single cell. So if it means two things, it's better to have them in two different columns. Mixed characters and numbers. So I had this the other day, had times recorded as 2 days. So that the letters DAYS were actually in there, and I needed just the number. So that's pretty easy to fix, but I had to fix it in 4 different places, which was a little bit slow. merge cells, they can make your spreadsheet look nice, which is okay, but I have to unmerge them in order to be able to read things in correctly to SAS. So that actually gets in the way. Color coding, computer does not see color. I one time had someone bring me a very large database with all this color coding in it, and I couldn't use it. He had his groups identified by color. I was able to retrieve it. Actually, I wrote a little Excel macro to detect the formatting and create a new column. But it was a little extra work, which could have been avoided if there had been a column there in the first place. Also, you can't sort by color. So it's nice to have a column there that you can sort by and organize your data with it. Upper and lowercase, the computer sees those as something different. It's not easy for me to, sorry, it's not hard for me to fix that, but just for consistency, you want to be aware that that's something that can be meaningful. I have, on occasion, had people give me data where upper and lowercase meant something different. So that could be important. Confused coding or formats. Most common one is probably dates that look like dates in Excel, but no, they aren't. So some people give me they've gone to a lot of trouble to color code everything, color code all the rows, and make things pretty, but that doesn't help me when I read it in the computer. So readable is good, but in terms of analysis, it doesn't have to be pretty. It can be, it doesn't hurt, but it can be extra work that sometimes actually gets in the way. And finally, identifying information. Unless it's really necessary for the analysis, you should probably remove anything identifying from all those HIPAA identifiers. We do see identifying information all the time. We try to make copies of it, but unnecessary copies are another risk for the patient for that information being released for wild. So not making copies of it and sending it to us is a good way for that not to get lost. The one possible piece of identifying information that we actually ask for is dates, because when we're calculating time to event, a lot of time we need that original date to be sure it's done correctly, which is why we get so fussy about dates. So here's an example of a spreadsheet which has some multiple problems. Up here it's good. He's giving me a key to his data, and it's on the row by itself, so that's good. I actually can take that out and use that somewhere else. The actual variables, some of these headers are blank. We have merge cells. We have different values in the same cell. We have multiple values in a single cell, so this was actually two measurements on the same patient at the same time, or I think this was a reliability study, so they actually had observers who disagreed whether it was a one or two, so they put both in there. So this needs some work to be turned into something which I could actually use. So I've taken out the key row, put that somewhere else. Now I have a name, simple name, in every column. I've taken away the merge cells. We have age, ethnicity, another ethnicity variable, and date. There's still, so we have NA for missing values. That's okay, because we're consistent about doing that. You see there's still some multiple values per cell. This was actually an exception where I had to do it in SAS. I converted those to two separate observations, and I used them in the analysis. So there are some exceptions where you can have multiple values separated by a comma, and I can use it, but it takes a little bit of pre-planning. The other common one for that would be medications, where you have many medications, and you might use numeric coding, and so you'd have 1, 2, 5, 8, 7, 11 for the medications that they were on. And then I can use the program to set up variables for each of those medications if they're needed.
So variables, we'd like to have a short name, which identifies things. Sometimes it's good to think of, if you were filing it, what would you file it under? So medication, type of medication, toxicity, type of toxicity. So you might organize your names in that fashion. Often you want a longer description, and you can maybe have a separate look. I'm gonna go, well, don't have it here. Plus, a lot of people will put a longer text description in a different row or in a different spreadsheet. And then I can use those longer descriptions labels and attach them to the analysis later. Having a key for your formatted values. So if one is yes, two is no, numeric coding, what do they need? And I actually use something very similar to just this in SAS to actually attach the text to the data values. And again, it's usually on a different sheet, but in my example, it was on the same sheet. That works, and it wasn't too hard to fix. A factor is like a variable, but a variable is one thing to a computer. A factor might be several variables in an analysis. So a common example would be dummy variables, where you have a yes or no for different levels for each level of the factor. So I guess dummy variables are the most common. I put time and event here. That's not really a factor. For time and event, you have, did the event occur? So relapse, death, and what time it occurred. So that's not a factor, because a factor is usually for explaining a result. And time to event is usually the result. But it's two variables in the analysis, and they have to be coded separately. Okay, so here's an example where I have a factor. Factor ABC can be A, B, or C, or none of those. So there's eight different combinations that are possible. And I've set up three dummy variables, which describe all eight of those possibilities. A really important question, and really one of the more common misconceptions we see when we're talking to people about their analyses, is the sample unit. And it's almost always the patient. If you have multiple observations on the same patient, you still have one patient and a repeated measures analysis, and then we need to do something to do properly account for multiple observations on each subject in the analysis. This presents some problems for recording data, just from a practical standpoint. So here's an example of what I call the wide layout. So we have sex, five subjects, sex, age, which group they're in, and then three blood pressure measurements, each of those systolic and diastolic. So this is sort of this is probably how most people would record this sort of data. So we have some demographic information here, and then the clinical or the analysis data there. The other way to record this is we have one row for each observation, so each subject repeats three times. There's a visit variable here now. Sex repeats three times for each person. Age repeats three times for each person. Group repeats three times for each person. Then systolic pressure and diastolic pressure are recorded just once for each person. So this is actually how we do a lot of analysis. I can convert between these two pretty easily in SAS, but it's not efficient for data entry because you have to enter a lot of things redundantly. So the other way, and now we're talking about an indexed database. So we have our data in two parts. And this is a useful idea that I want to try to express. We have our demographic data, where each patient is identified and demographic factors recorded. Then we might have our study data or our clinical data, where there are multiple observations for each patient that are linked by the study ID number. So critical part is you have a key variable which links those two,
and I can put those together in SAS. The advantage here is there's no wasted space, nothing's repeated unnecessarily. All your systolic blood pressures are in a column. It's very easy to spot something which is probably misentered. We have a missing value there. Scratch the missing value we have in the other one. And this is less repeated effort. It's a little more work to set up. If you have something simple, that format's fine. If you have something more complicated, this is really essential. So there's a process called a merge, database merge, where we put these two things together. And when I do that, that actually is what the computer will duplicate these values very easily if that's what I need for the analysis. So there's a database program that almost everybody has available, Microsoft Access. I think in 15 years, I've seen two or three people actually use Access for their research. Everyone has it. No one actually understands how to use it. Problem, I think, is it's very business-oriented and not research-oriented. So unless you have some prior experience using it, it's not very practical to use. And if you're doing a small study, boy, it sure is easy just to throw your data in the spreadsheet, proof check it a couple times, and then you're ready to go. A better approach, which is becoming available, is we have a web cap server on campus now through bioinformatics. Actually, there's several now. This is a database package designed specifically for research. It stores your data on a secure web server. You can log into a web page and enter your data, and then it will, when you're ready for the analysis, give you back your database either in a spreadsheet or ready for a SAS format. I can import it directly. We also has SPSS and STATA formats. So it will do a lot of the organizing work for you. Furthermore, it forces you to set up those rules beforehand for how you want to record your data. And it really gets you thinking about those important questions. I have occasionally gotten data in SurveyMonkey. SurveyMonkey can be just awful for analysis because it's, I think it may be intentional. They offer analysis services, so they don't want to give you data that's easy to analyze. It can really be really hard to make some useful out of SurveyMonkey data, unless it's very simple. And RedCap now has a survey package that's a lot like SurveyMonkey that will do the same thing for you. So the contact person for that is Mark Wyman of Bioinformatics, and he's very helpful. Ideas, have a plan for your data. I like to recommend that people actually pilot your database. So when you're planning your study, you can make up what your database should look like. If it's a spreadsheet, put some values in there. It doesn't have to be real data, that's okay, take it out later. But when you have your data, what's it gonna look like? And could you actually use that for analysis? And getting people thinking about those sort of questions saves a lot of work later on. Think with data, then you can research. Okay. That's about all I've got. I guess I should point out, if you come to our consulting services, sometimes we have students working on projects. We have some of our students here today that they had to come. but usually it's some of our more senior students who help us in the consulting service. They get some good experience and we get some good efforts out of them. Haley, anything else?
Nope. If you are receiving CME credit, just leave that evaluation form in back or email me and indicate that. Okay? Thanks for coming.
Thanks for your time today. I have some cards back there. Or if you have any questions, I'll hang around for a while.